This is a really special guest. She's a writer, she's a speaker, she's an educator, she's a teacher, she's a family therapist. But most, I think importantly, she's a mom. And she's on a spiritual path. She's been meditating since she was 17 years old.
Hi. She appears.
She appears. Susan Stiffelman. She's written this book called Parenting Without Power Struggles. Whoa. Hey. Really excellent. I tell you, when I read the first couple of chapters, this is not just about parenting. It's about our relationships with everybody. Mm-hmm. Truly.
It's true. It's true. Mothers-in-law and yeah, neighbors and
exactly.
Bosses and employees.
Yes, yeah. Co-workers. Woo! Just in the first two chapters. Really good stuff. Really good pointers. It was interesting how Susan has come here. It was an event, synchronistic event that happened that brought Susan here. We were in Malibu. Susan lives in Malibu. Can I say this?
Of course.
Okay. Eckhart and I were looking for a place in Malibu to rent. And so we had phoned up and we were gonna go see a few places and we'd come to Susan's house. We didn't know who Susan was at all. So we were just there as, you know, actually Eckhart was probably even hoping he wouldn't be recognized or something, you know. Like we wanted to be incognito. And then Susan mentioned, she goes, oh, wow. I think you hesitated, you said.
I didn't
even
say to, for a while. Yeah, I just yeah, showed you the house.
It was almost near the end that she decided to reveal that she just wrote this article for our newsletter on parenting. And, you know, I had no idea. I read that article probably one or two days before. And we thought, wow, this is totally incredible. And then, you know, Eckhart was saying, you got to do something with her. And I go, yeah, I know. It's too coincidental that this happened. But, you know, for me, I know it's always been when I look at things, what serendipitous sort of events happen, if they hit me three times, I know it's supposed to be really fantastic. That this event, it's gotta just happen, like without a doubt. So that was the first synchronistic event. The second, because when we met her, she gave me her book. So I thought to myself, we hadn't asked her yet whether she was going to come on. I thought, well, I got to read the book first, even though it was a serendipitous event. I mean, who knows? Maybe this is crazy stuff in here.
This woman in Malibu.
But then I read, oops, I'll need my glasses too. Oh, life, huh? Okay. And then I read just the, you know how you have a dedication? Somebody mm-hmm. you dedicate to. And she dedicated, of course, to her son,
oh.
Ari. Where is it? So and then I read this, a line in her dedication. I love you to the moon and back and from every corner of my heart. And for me, that was another sign mm-hmm. because I went, holy cow, this is the same energy that I feel, that yeah. love and that connection. Because I used to say to my daughter, Erin, I love you more than the whole universe. And I put out my arms like this, you know, and it was the exact same energy. Mm-hmm. I can feel this through your words here. And I thought, oh, wow, this is great. I thought, okay. And then, you know, Stephen calls and he says, you know, okay, but if you're going to ask her, you got to ask her now. We can't just wait. You have to do it. Okay, we'll do it. And I'm like, geez, I usually have that third sign coming around. I wonder where that third sign is. I was going to do it anyways, but I thought, oh, I really like that three, you know? And then we didn't end up going to Susan's house. We ended up renting a house elsewhere. But then I thought, I went to Starbucks one day and I just had a feeling I was going to meet her. So I thought, okay, I'm just gonna go see if this is gonna, you know, happen or not. So I'm in Starbucks and Malibu, very laid back. It takes a long time to get a drink. Very, very laid back. You can have two people ahead of you and it's like having 20 people ahead of you. But anyway, so I'm waiting and I'm like, you know, kind of in a way keeping my eye out for Susan because I really felt like I was going to meet her. And I thought this would be the third sign. Got my drink, heading out towards the door, tasted the drink and I was about to turn around because I thought, oh, they made the wrong thing here. And then, voila, she literally walks right in front of me and she just opens the door and steps in. I went, holy cow. I didn't tell you that then.
You did not tell me
that. No, and I went, holy cow. I go, this is incredible. This is my third sign. And I knew I wanted to call her all week, but as I said, when we got to Malibu, we actually didn't want to do anything. Mm-hmm. And it took me until the day before we're going to leave and say, okay, we're leaving tomorrow, so I guess we do need to meet and talk about what we're going to talk about. Huh. Anyways, we met yesterday when Eckhart was here in session, and we met 20 minutes before he was coming into session here, and thought, okay, she'll have plenty of time to go back in and we'll have plenty of time. 20 minutes is enough to connect and, you know, talk about what we're going to maybe talk about. 2 hours went by. Yeah. And here we're just talking. And then, you know, even after 1 hour, I said, you know what? We really have to stop talking because we may not have anything to talk about during the filming. And we're like, okay, we'll talk about something else. So we talk a few things about something else. But then, of course, we get right back into the parenting. So I love this. I love you. I mean, there's just such this heart connection and something that just resonates. This is a real live parent, you know?
For sure.
A live parent. There's so many questions that Eckhart gets asked, you know, and he answers it, you know, about being present, but it doesn't get down to the nitty gritty of, you know, how do you get your kids to do the dishes when they've procrastinated after 3 days or something, you know? Right. It's like gets to the really nitty gritty, the heart of it.
And as you said, one of the cornerstones has to do with this idea of being the captain of the ship. And the way I illustrate that, can I kind of show you, mm-hmm. right? So this hand represents the parent, and this hand represents the child. And when the hand is above, the parent hand is above the child's hand, then we call that being the captain of the ship. So the child might say, can I have ice cream for breakfast this morning? And if you don't think that's a good idea, then you may say, I'm afraid not, sweetheart. And then the child will say, why not?
Please.
Right? So, because ice cream's good. And one of the beautiful things about children is they are in the moment. And they're not really thinking about calories or sugar content or, you know, protein needs. They're just, ice cream is good. Can I have some? Yeah. Depending, of course, on the age of the child. You would hope your 17-year-old has a little bit more understanding. But they may also want the ice cream, and in which case they're probably going to have it. So the idea with a younger child, at least, that you're captaining the ship and you're capable of dealing with their unhappiness. And I'll get to that a little bit later. So the child says, can I have ice cream? I'm afraid not. Why not? Because you won't eat your dinner. Yes, I will. No, honey, I let you have ice cream last night and you didn't eat your dinner. That's because you made that weird stew. I hate that stew. What do you mean you hate that stew? You eat that stew at grandma's all the time. Yeah, but grandma makes it differently. No, I use grandma's
recipe.
Sounds familiar, right?
So, did you notice?